Professor Julia Yeomans, who is coming from the Oxford University here in the United Kingdom. Her talk will be on active nematic liquid crystals. Let us welcome our speaker.
Yes, so that's an excellent question, and sorry if I don't know. I expect it's a finite size effect. So the spindle is not an infinite system, right?
Yeah.
I expect it's a finite size effect. And so if you look at the theory, which you know we wrote down, there are instabilities which occur at large, you know, like wave width.
Mm-hmm.
But then one can argue, you know, there'll be only a finite drop of the stuff.
Yeah.
So that's what I suspect is going on.
Okay, so what I'm going to talk about, there's lots of the same words in, but it's really rather a different system. And I'm a theorist, I do theory and simulations. So I'm also going to show you some lovely experiments that they're borrowed from other people, in particular from Bonnie Mendogic's group at Radalice. This is the other place I'm sitting here. Before I start, this is work carried out by my postdoc, Sivash Tanki, and my colleague at Oxford, Roman Goldstein. We've heard about an active system, a finite active system, which is a spindle. What I'm going to tell you about is dense active systems. And one of the big advantages of being a theorist is that you can look at lots of different systems, because you don't have to change your lab each time. So I'm going to show you about something strange that happens in 2D active systems. You see something which looks like turbulence, but I get told off for calling it turbulence for reasons which I'll explain to you. And then what I want to do is try and understand generically why this occurs. And we've got ideas, I don't know if they're right, but I'll explain the ideas we've got. But on the way, really, I'd like to tell you a bit about active systems and the sort of theories we use to describe them. And you might well say, why is she talking at a conference on liquid crystals? But you'll see at least very obvious mathematical analogies between what I'm talking about and the dynamical theory of liquid crystals. So let's start by looking at these various different sorts of dense active systems. So first of all, what is an active system? An active system is one which creates its own energy. Okay, so it's a system often which is alive, although sometimes we cheat a bit and have things like vibrated granular matter when you're continuously pumping energy in. And very much like in the last talk, these systems are not in thermodynamic equilibrium. Their natural state is to exist out of thermodynamic equilibrium. And both of the talks this morning, how do we understand the collective behaviour of these systems? These are bacteria, two-dimensional layer of bacteria, and they're swimming around, and you end up with patterns looking like this. Lots of swirls, definitely unstable, which is why I have done that question, and we'd like to understand why. It looks like turbulence, but that's really, it can't be turbulence. And the reason is that these things are tiny, they're moving at velocities which on our length scales are very slow, typically 10-100 microns per second. And so if you work out the Reynolds number, there are very low Reynolds numbers. And turbulence is a high Reynolds number phenomena. What happens when you have loads of inertia when you're looking at things like waterfalls? At these small length scales, which are the ones you're used to for, say, liquid crystals and microchannels, things are flowing in a laminar sort of way, and you just don't get turbulence. So I'll probably use that word, but this is a different sort of phenomena, and it needs different explanations. This is just a way of looking at the same thing. Really, so that people look at lots of different systems and see that they look the same, these are vorticity plots. So they're a plot of how the angular velocity, essentially, of the fluid. So the red bits, the blue is going around in one direction and the blue bits is going around in the other direction. So this is just a picture in colour of the swirliness you were seeing in that first picture. Okay, so bacteria do this. These are cells which live on the inside of blood vessels. Same sort of picture, in particular near dividing cells. This is a shaken granular layer, so it's actually just grains of rice and macroscopic things which are shaken up and down on the turntable. Same picture, same, you get this swirliness going on. And then here's a fish, same sort of picture, you know. Is this the same? Is there anything? Are there, you see, theoretical physicists are really bad at understanding more than one thing at once, so we need to take everything and make it generic. See if there's anything we can do to understand these systems, which is going to be the same from one system to the other. These now are the simulations, some simulations, not the ones I'm going to talk about, but what these are is just rods. These rods are just moving with some velocity, and they have an excluded volume interaction so that they just bounce off each other and actually tend to align as they come towards each other. So a very simple system. Again, as long as these rods have a certain length to width ratio, which is of order 5, you get same sorts of pictures. And this is a very different system. It's a very different system because it doesn't have hydrodynamics in there. But it sort of looks the same. Okay, so that's a whole list of things. We'd like to try and explain this turbulent-like state. And to do that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at two particular systems. First of all, an experimental system, which is very like the one Dan talked about, because it's a mixture of microtubules and molecular motors. And then the continuum theory, which is very like what Nigel was telling you about this morning. And I'm going to show you that actually we can measure things which are the same in the two cases. And therefore, maybe we are seeing the same sort of physics, but it'd be nice to actually explain what that physics is. And I'll tell you our ideas. And our ideas are that topological defects are important, which again brings it back to your way, well, to everyone's way. And this is very much a liquid crystal sort of thing. So the first of these systems is molecular motors, which we've been hearing about. And I can't remember if we showed you this picture. Isn't this amazing that these motors, here's a motor, and it's working, walking along a microtubule and pulling some sort of cargo behind it. And in your body, there are millions of these things walking up and down, basically being the engines of our body. And the first time I saw that picture, I thought, oh yeah, you know, some artist, some sort of science fiction thing. And then I learned a bit more about it, and you know, after a bit of reading, it was wow, because they really are like this. They really are like the feet that walk along the microtubules. And I think it's nice to ask why bother with microtubules. And the answer is that these motors are really tiny. And because they're tiny, thermal fluctuations would just back them all over the place unless they had some way of tethering themselves down. So that's why we've evolved to have a transport system which has tracks so that the motors can hang onto the tracks and beat thermal fluctuations. And they really do look like this. This is a protein, and the way it works is that an ATP molecule, I hope I've got the chemistry right, joins onto that back foot. And the molecule changes the configuration of the protein in a very subtle way so that it actually wants to flip forwards. So it really is just a configuration thing. It flips forwards and it walks, and then it releases an ADP molecule, and then the whole thing repeats itself. It really is really clever. The system I'm looking at is not a million miles away from the one we've heard about. It's a mixture of these motors, these molecular motors, actually kinesin motors, and microtubules. So these curly things that you see here are bundles of these microtubules. It's a bit like the picture we saw. And the motors are formed into little clusters, and one end grabs onto this microtubule, and the other end grabs onto that microtubule. And if the polarity is right, as these things move, they move, they pull this one that way, and they push that one that way, and you get motion of these microtubules relative to each other. If they happen to stick between two like that, then you've had it, because they won't go anywhere. You need them moving relative to each other like that. I should say that these were from the Dodgick Lab at Brandeis, and these are absolutely beautiful experiments. Here you see the velocity field. White things are these microtubules moving around. The yellow things are the velocity field on top of that. And let's just make a movie, which I couldn't manage to. Whoops, sorry. There we go. Ed, please work. Yesterday.
The velocity field is 2D or 3D?
It's all 2D. This is all on the surface. So I'm talking always about 2D. Here are the movies. You can see these microtubules swirling around. What the motors are doing is pushing them relative to each other. That's giving you these swirls again. Okay? So these things, the bundles sort of get bigger and bigger, and then they buckle over and swirl. You get velocity fields just like the ones I've shown you. And the difference here is just more ATP, more fuel for the system. So these guys are moving faster because they've got lots of little motors running around trying to pull them relative to each other. Now, the particularly wonderful thing about these experiments, as indeed the experiments we've just seen, but these measured something, well, and again, correlation functions is what's being measured here. What the Dodgick experiments measured is the velocity-velocity correlation function as a function of distance. So what this tells you is how the velocity is correlated between one place in this system and another place. If the velocity here is in a certain direction, what's the velocity a distance far away? So close to, the velocities tend to be the same, and as you move away, this correlation goes away. So if you like, this is going to be some sort of measure of the degree of swirliness in this system. And here is the raw data. This is this velocity-velocity correlation function as a function of R. And going up is increasing the number of molecular motors, increasing the amount of activity. And that makes sense, right? Because if you bung in more motors, things are going to move faster because you're pushing it harder. And then what you can do is you can normalize these, i.e. you can plot them on a scale so that you've got one here. So you just move them so they're all on the same scale. And if you do that, you end up with a plot like this. Okay? Just move the curve so they're all at 1 here, for R is 0. And what you notice is that the data collapses. And this is a good data collapse, because this is a biological system, and any data you can see, any sort of pattern at all, is brilliant in a biological system, which is why Dan's experiments are so amazing. Okay? So this data collapse on top of each other. So what's that saying? It's saying that there's a length scale in this system, a certain length scale, which is about 100 microns, which is independent of the activity, independent of how much you're driving the system, independent of the amount of energy you're putting in there. And that's weird, right? I mean, why should there be a length scale that's independent of activity? Okay, so those are the experiments. Those are the experiments we're going to come back and try and explain. Now let's look at the theory. And again, it's a continuum theory. It's not a million miles away from what Dan was talking about, but all these continuum theories are a bit different, and I'm going to introduce it in slightly different way. The theory for these systems is very like liquid crystal hydrodynamics, which is really why we're here. Okay? And it's liquid crystal hydrodynamics written in terms of the Q tensor. The equations for the motion are well known. Some of you will have heard of Erickson-Leslie-Parodi equations, yeah? Liquid crystal hydrodynamics in terms of the director field. This is just a generalization in terms of the Q tensor, i.e. Navier-Stokes equations, but written in terms of Q, essentially. Q is my order parameter, you know about that. Okay, I haven't written out the details of these equations, but the main thing is that the order parameter is advected by the flow. Okay, the liquid crystal molecules move with the flow. They're rotated by the flow, because if I have any sort of shear flow, that's going to rotate anything which is a liquid crystal. And then they relax to some minimum of a free energy, the thing comes to equilibrium. And usually that free energy is a Landau-Degen free energy, which I'm sure you've seen earlier today. And then you couple that to an equation for the velocity field, which is essentially just Navier-Stokes with knobs on, a continuity equation which tells you how the density evolves, a Navier-Stokes equation which tells you how the velocity evolves, and the difference for a liquid crystal is just that the stress is more complicated. And the reason the stress is more complicated is that if a liquid crystal molecule moves around, in particular if it turns, it's going to batch the fluid around, and it's going to induce flows. So you have this backflow effect, it's usually called. But we don't have to worry about that, mostly because the liquid crystal community has done all the worrying and understands that perfectly. What we need to do is say, what I've got now is an active system. It's producing energy. How do I put an extra term in this equation? So I've got an equation which models that production of energy. And the answer is this. You bung on a term which actually looks very easy. It's just proportional to Q. And that zeta thing is just a measure of the strength of the activity. A measure, if you like, of the number of ATP molecules in this system. And this occurs in the stress tensor. It occurs under a derivative. So the point is that any time you have any gradients in the director field, the director field has any sort of kinks in, you'll get flow coming out. And anytime you have a change in the magnitude of the pneumatic order, you'll also get a flow field generated. It's far from obvious why that's the case. I'm just going to say it. But I'm going to show you the sort of flow fields you get, because those are very special for active systems. Turns out that these active systems, all the forces come in equal and opposite pairs. And if you think about it a bit, they have to, because they're producing their own energy. The whole point of a bacteria is that it swims itself, and you're not pushing it around. It's got to produce its own energy, okay? And so you're not putting a force on it. And so from Newton's law, any force has to come in an equal and opposite pair. So if you draw the forces on these systems, essentially a bacterium has a thrust on the head, and a drag on the tail, which have to be equal and opposite to each other. And in this kinesin, it's the same thing. Really, the microtubules are moving relative to each other, so when this one moves down, that one moves up. And you have equal and opposite forces in these systems. Now, who's used to electrostatics? Okay, you remember? Those of you that are physicists are meant to remember that in the dim and distant past you did electromagnetism. Yeah? Dipoles, when do you remember dipoles from? Yeah? Tell me about dipoles. All right, so you've got a charge, you have a potential, equal and opposite charges, then you end up with a field around it which goes as 1 over r squared, and you end up with a dipole field, because the basic monopole terms cancel out. It's really the same story here, except for hydrodynamics instead of for electrostatics. Because you have those dipole sources, because you have a dipole, the flow field looks very different. If you just have a force, for example, you have a colloid which is pulled through this fluid, then what happens is that the flow field just follows it through the fluid like that. If you have one of these dipoles, like a little swimmer here, the flow field looks very different. And you can see, okay, what you can see is that the flow field forms these loops around the swimmer. And if you look at the symmetry of that flow field, that has a nematic symmetry. It's the same on that side as on that side. And it turns out that these different flow fields are responsible for really quite a lot of the properties of active systems when you start putting them into fluids. And it's because of these weird flow fields that you have to use that Q in the equations of motion. Now, what I'm going to do now is, remember we've got all these swirls. Those are instabilities. If I start with a nematic state, it will become unstable. I'm now going to try and explain to you why that nematic state becomes unstable. Here's a nematic state, okay? And there's always going to be a tiny little fluctuation like that. Because of this tiny little fluctuation, I have more, a higher density here, if you like, a larger source pushing the flow field, and so the flow field here is going to be bigger than the flow field out here. So if I draw the flow field, let's say it goes in this direction, depends just on the sign of the term I use, the flow field is going to be bigger here than out here, because this fluctuation means that I have more swimmers there, if you like, or more motors driving that flow field. So what have I got here? A bigger flow field there than there. That's like a shear flow. What do shear flows do to liquid crystals? And the answer is that they can either make them tumble or align. Okay? So what actually happens in this particular setup is that you get this tumbling in the shear, and that tumbling pushes this instability more, so they just move more and point more towards each other. And so what happens is that these states just become unstable. If you put a nematic, if you have one of these active nematics and put this active term in, what's going to happen is that you actually get this really chaotic state where you get all the swirls. So we do understand why you get a turbulent-like state. We do understand why you get a chaotic sort of state. Let's just see it in the simulations now. These are our simulations. We just solved those equations of motion. Same sort of story, right? This instability is leading to these twirls. But having got this state, it would be nice to be able to understand why it looks like that. Okay, let's home in. Let's just sort of do a microscope on this. Let's look at that square there. Okay? And as you go closer and closer, you can start seeing the director field here. These lines of the flow field. These molecule things here are the director field. Okay? We've got an instability that's giving us this state, but how are we going to characterize this state? Because if we don't know how to describe it, which we haven't done for about 5 years, how can we decide whether these different systems have the same turbulent-like behavior? So, anyone got any ideas? Look at that thing there. What do you think you can see? Yeah.
Defect.
A defect, yeah. So we thought, okay, let's look at the simulation and actually let's look and see what the defects are doing. Because you can fairly easily identify topological defects. This is a nematic, so the topological defects are plus or minus a half. If I've got right, sorry, there we here. So this is what I'm doing. This is the same simulation. See if the movie will move. Okay. And you can see the topological defects there. The red ones are plus and the blue ones are minus, or possibly the other way around. And you can see them doing what defects are meant to do and annihilating each other. There's the bad luck. Yeah. But what's strange in these systems is that also you're getting defects created. I'll just play that again so you can find a couple which are being created. Okay, there's a pair there which appeared. You have to look carefully. Going to appear here. Look. That, there's two. And that's different. That's different in active systems from passive systems. Yeah?
And this is a simulation.
This is a simulation, yes. But I'll show you the same thing in the experiments at the end. This
so
is
no
just.
No integer
defects. Sorry?
No integer defects.
No integer defects, though. There's a plus and minus a half defect. So it's really like a pneumatic, but what's different is that because you're pumping in energy, you can get this plus and minus defect created. And it's a simulation in that it's, I'm never quite sure whether to call it a simulation, it's just a numerical solution of those Q tensor equations of motion. So, are we anything like the experiments? Remember, which I was going to say first, but it doesn't matter, we can do it this way around. Remember, that's the picture we had for the experiments. We looked at the velocity-velocity correlation function normalized, and there was a length scale independent of the activity. So let's plot exactly the same thing for the simulations. These are the simulations. Here's the velocity-velocity correlation function, which is normalized. Exactly the same story. Okay, these two aren't great. These are low activities where we think something a bit different is happening, but all the high activity ones fall very nicely on the same curve. And that's good, because it means that now maybe the physics is the same in the simulations and the experiments. So my question was, we've got a length scale here. What is it? Okay, and I said we've got defects. So maybe the length scale is the distance between the defects. That would be a nice length scale in the system. Okay? So how would I find that out? How would I check that? Well, what I'd have to do is I'd have to scale this axis with the length scale between the defects. So what I'm going to show you now is a picture of the same thing with this axis scaled with the length scale between the defects. So let's see if that works. Okay. This is the velocity-velocity correlation function. This is the length scale where this is density of defects to the half, i.e. 1 over the length scale between the defects. Doesn't work, does it? I mean, those things don't collapse on each other. That's really bad. That is not the right length scale in this system. So we then left around a bit. Okay, and what we found was that we got scaling. Everything seemed to fall very nicely on top of each other, as long as we had a length which scaled as 1 over n squared k. So my length scales as 1 over n squared k. Okay. Where n is the density of defects and k is the elastic constant in the system. So as theoretical physicists do, we mucked around till we found that. Now we have to look for an explanation. And the explanation we think is right, we're not certain, but we think is right at the moment, we might change our minds in a couple of weeks, okay, is that the defects have something to do with it. But it's not just the distance between the defects that matters. What it is actually the dynamics of the defects. These defects are created all the time, and they're destroyed all the time. And so you have to come to a steady state where you have a certain number of defects. So what I'm going to do now is try and show you how this scaling comes out of this idea of a picture of defect dynamics. And it's sort of a bit tricky, this, okay, I think we'll manage it. This is what I'm trying to find, that my length scale scales as 1 over n squared times k, density of defects times elastic constants. And also, while I'm at it, remember, I said that that length scale was independent of the activity. So what's going to come out of my theory is those two things. So let's see if we can do it. We've got these defects being created and destroyed. You've seen that, okay? So let's write down the simplest thing we can possibly do. The rate of change of the number of defects is equal to the rate of creation of the defects minus the rate of destruction of the defects. And what's going to happen in equilibrium is the rate of creation of the defects and the rate of destruction of the defects have to balance each other. Okay? So what I want to do is balance this term and that term and hopefully get out the right scale. So, rate of creation of the defects. We believe, and this is slightly iffy at the moment, we do have some ideas, but I'm not going to go into them about why this is true, and numerically it works. Okay? Rate of creation of the defects is proportional to this thing, which is the amount of energy being pumped in. That makes sense. If you pump it harder, you get more defects. And 1 over k, because if it's a stiff thing elastically, if k is big, it's harder to make defects. Rate of destruction, well, we just assume that these things move around at random, and when they hit each other, a plus and a minus, they destroy each other, and that's just like kinetic theory. And from kinetic theory, you can write down a mean free path, and if you think about it a bit, from a mean free path, you can write down a rate of collisions. But the problem is we have a velocity in here, we don't know what velocity is, so we just do the simplest possible way of estimating the velocity. And the simplest possible way is to say I've got to balance the energy that I put in from the active stress and the energy I take out due to the viscous dissipation. And if you think about it a bit, that balance, the balance that the energy you're putting in comes out as viscous dissipation, will give me a velocity length squared. And if I put in that velocity, what I find for this term, which is the rate of decay of these defects, putting everything together, it comes out like this. And then I balance the rate of creation with the rate of destruction, and what I end up with is a formula which looks like that, where that L is my length scale. So first of all the activities, all these zeta things drop out, that's good, because I wanted a length scale independent of activity. And then if I work out what L is, I come out with 1 over n squared k, and that's good, that's what I wanted. So it fits. If I think of this active system, this turbulent state, as a gas of defects which are being created and being destroyed, everything fits so far. Okay? And back to the experiments now. We looked at the experiments first, we would have done better, I think. We went back and we saw that, in fact, this is what's happening. You're getting bends in these microtubules. You can see here defects being created. This one tends to move away. That's because round a defect, you have distortions in the director field. As I told you, distortions in the director field is what drives this active flow. And so you can see these things moving apart. So that, again, seems to fit between the theory and the defects. And then what we did, let's do that again, okay, is we set up some of these distortions. I mean, the way we think this is happening is that the active flow, the instability, is producing distortions, and then the distortions, just because they've got loads of elastic energy, decay into these. But we're still faffing around trying to understand this. properly. So, that's my summary. My thesis is that there is now evidence that active defects are important in controlling this turbulent light state because it gives the right scaling for the parameters. There are loads of things that we still don't understand. That formula for the rate of defect formation was certainly a bit iffy, seems to work, we don't really understand where it comes from. That needs sorting out. We assume kinetic theory for the defect annihilation, which I think probably is a pretty good approximation, but it would be nice to get that cross-section better. Our systems are incompressible, probably the real systems are much more compressible. They seem to be able to, the defects seem to be much softer than the ones in the simulations. And when we've got that sorted out, we can get back to the question we first thought of, which is how generic is this picture? Are the motors and microtubules behaving in the same way as the swimmers, which I suspect is yes? Are those behaving in the same way as the granular systems? And that's much more of a question mark. Thank you.
Because this morning, from a very interesting and entertaining session.